Hello, everyone. My name is Nandini Ramani, and I'm responsible for monitoring and observability at AWS. Welcome to today's first AWS Cloud Innovation Talk, which is on cloud operations. So we are kicking it off. And a lot has happened since I saw probably most of you here last year at reInvent. It's been a year of change, a year of innovation, and it's been super exciting to work with each and every one of you on taking cloud operations to the next level. So today, we get a lot of questions from many customers such as yourself asking, how does AWS think about cloud operations, both internally and for our customers? And so today, we are going to share with you some of our insights on cloud operations at AWS. We're going to share some of the new launches and releases and capabilities of our services. And we're also going to tell you our vision for cloud operations of the future. So here at AWS, we believe cloud operations is essential for operational excellence. And cloud operations has two components. The first of it is setting up your environment for governance. How do you set it up? Do you have the right rules, the right processes, and the right reports to support your cloud usage toward your business goals? Do you have all the needs to match your organizations and how you organize yourself within your company in order to save time and money, improve your compliance, as well as going to market sustainably? All of this while allowing you not to worry about cloud operations, but to focus on innovating on behalf of your customers. The second pillar of cloud operations is full observability into your entire environment so that you can take actions to remediate quickly and reduce your mean time to resolution. And the third most important piece is, no matter what business you are in, no matter what size your company is, cloud operations really helps you bring great application experiences for your customers. And it also allows you to create a developer experience internally so you can deliver those end user experiences that are delightful. So, what better way to kick off cloud operations than to ask you, our customers, to join me in telling me how? So we're doing a live poll. Please scan the QR code and enter the number you see on your screen here. And if that doesn't work, there's a link that you can type in. Hopefully it'll just work. We are, like I said, the first of the kickoff sessions, so if we have a glitch, I apologize. So you see here four options. I could have made a longer list than this, honestly. But all of these are equally important. However, what is your organization's primary goal is the question. Is it automating operations, improving resiliency and compliance, enhancing developer productivity, or maintaining governance and compliance? We have the poll results. So it looks like improving resilience and performance, which would have been my first pick anyway, seems to be slightly ahead of automating operations, which is also equally important because the more you automate, the more you can spend time on innovation rather than just maintaining your estate. So what I would say is whichever, no matter which of these is your goals, and I do believe depending on the day and week I ask you, these results could be different. So no matter what it is, talking to customers of all sizes in different industry verticals, we believe that cloud operations can really help you deliver all of these outcomes. And one thing that's in there, which I think was a distinct fourth, is creating, enhancing internal developer productivity for your own engineering teams, which is super critical. And so what better way? Here at AWS, we believe in telling all our stories through the voice of the customer. So we're going to kick it off by bringing in our first customer who will share how they use cloud operations to help transform their own internal developer experience so they could deliver better end applications for their customers. So please join me in welcoming the first voice of the customer. Please welcome Sandhya from JP Morgan Chase. Welcome, Sandhya.
I think you were missing all of the above option because I would have picked all of the above.
Right.
So efficient cloud operations is critical to accelerate innovation and improve security, reliability, scalability, and cost for deploying and managing applications. Right? But before we get deep into that, I want to share a few things about JP Morgan. We have over 150 years of experience building trust. We serve customers and clients around the world, individuals and their local communities, corporations and government. We've always operated at immense speed. Our reach is vast. As you can tell, our magnitude is huge. We have over $24 trillion in assets in custody. We process over $10 trillion of payments daily, and we serve millions of customers with a wide range of financial services. We also spend a north of $15 billion in technology. But did you know that JP Morgan was the first to invest in Edison's idea to invent the light bulb? We were also one of the very early financial services to migrate workloads to public cloud. Innovation, speed, and disruption is in our DNA. But we are also one of the largest technology companies. With over 35,000 software engineers, we have over 600 million lines of active code. We do north of 120,000 builds a day, and we do run 100 million synthetic sessions and tests per month. But and to make things more interesting and adventurous, we just not have scale. We have high degree of variance in our ecosystem. Our portfolio is written in variety of languages. Our applications are deployed across in on-prem, private cloud, virtualized environments, as well as public cloud. And they all support diverse set of business processes and functions, with each of them having its own compliance and regulatory challenges. We also maintain a high number of heritage applications, many of which is going through the process of modernizing. You know, modernization does offer great benefits, but the complexity, heterogeneity magnify our challenges. You know, one of the big complexity is also we operate in a highly regulated environment, right? And we take this responsibility seriously. We have a very complex application estate, and we've been rapidly modernizing across various dimensions, rewrite, replatform, rehost to public cloud, as well as to modern and more efficient data centers. We leverage a lot of public cloud providers, AWS being the largest, and general purpose cloud. And you know, as part of this, our transformation journey is super complex, and it's essential that we do not lose track of security, reliability, and most important, customer and client experience. So you know, to me, it's like flying a jet, fueling it, repairing and replacing parts of it all at the same time, without spiraling the jet or causing chaos or panic for the crew or passengers. Right? So, you know, simplifying cloud operation tasks such as provisioning, observability, security compliance is of high priority for us. So we're investing in best-of-breed technologies that will help us simplify, provide us deep telemetry, and help us be secure. We need real-time insights across our entire stack, allowing for proactive monitoring, troubleshooting, and optimization for security, performance, and reliability. So how do we do that? Right? It cannot just be the job of operations team or the SRE teams. It has to be built in with your infrastructure and application development process. But there's already a cognitive overload on software engineers, right? They're multitasking. They have to learn evolving technologies, frameworks, network configurations, compliance checks, right? And then on top of that, I'm asking them to integrate observability right from day one. This is just not sustainable. Most would rather just focus on writing code and delivering value to their end customers, right? This is having a big impact on engineer productivity and experience. So in order to abstract this complexity and reduce this cognitive overload, we formed a business that focuses on that integrated engineer experience via self-service. Deep integration with the IDE to reduce that context switching, and providing data and insights at the fingertips of engineers in the context of what they're doing. So we have a centralized environment with a set of pre-configured tools, frameworks, services, resources that will help them develop, test, and deploy their code. These are wrapped into a set of patterns and blueprints. These patterns help abstract the complexity of infrastructure and controls and compliance away from the developers, but yet providing the context so they can focus on writing code and delivering applications. And these capabilities need to be made available where the engineers are spending most of their time, within the IDE or the developer portal. Right? So, access to these pattern builds with built-in observability needs to be made easy for developers. Easy access to these patterns not only accelerate engineers with a set of strategic, standardized, and repeatable constructs, but it also helps them adhere to industry best practices. These patterns have built-in security, controls, and compliance checks, and by adopting these patterns, we have taken away a significant amount of toil and made production deployments faster and safer. We've also made it easy to completely shift left the setting up of the observability stack from dev stage to production, right? So, and then observability as code has helped us with the automation of these best practices and also laying down the right stack based on the workloads and where you're deploying those workloads. Observability as code has also helped us simplify scaling these practices. Now, we have now shifted from a bottoms-up approach in terms of monitoring just the infrastructure to a more tops-down view, the full application stack monitoring. Now, with the use of AI, we are accelerating our engineers with coding assistance, faster discovery of information, troubleshooting, and anomaly detection. So due to scale and heterogeneous nature of our environments, we have data spread across many observability solutions. So in order to avoid this fragmented experience, we are investing in a unified platform that supports the red and use frameworks and also helps us observe our full stack running across multiple clouds as well as on-prem. At JP Morgan, we use AWS CloudWatch for our hybrid cloud observability. Our applications generate billions of CloudWatch events a day. We use native capabilities for metrics, events, logs, and traces, as well as dashboarding and cross-account observability. This delivers a single pane of glass view across our multiple environments. So this unified platform improves the software engineer experience and significantly improves our speed for anomaly and failure detection, but most importantly, speed of recovery. And leveraging game day testing has advanced our platform resiliency by enabling teams to adopt chaos testing as part of their migration to public cloud. So moving our engineer and observability platforms to AWS has enabled us to deliver truly elastic services. And we've seen an upwards of 40% improvement in our performance and reliability metrics. So I really look forward to hearing all about all the innovation and offering the AWS team has in 2024. With that, I would like to hand the stage back to Nandini. Thank you.
Thank you, Sandhya, for sharing this amazing story of how JP Morgan Chase transformed its developer experience as they moved to the cloud. What an amazing shift left story from Sandhya on how they improved the scale and frequency of their deployments, improving latency and performance, and overall end customer experience. So now, let's take a look at how AWS helps customers such as JP Morgan Chase accomplish these outcomes. So this is a slide you're familiar with. I already showed you this. Let's first talk about setup and governance. At AWS, just like all of you, we were facing a lot of our own issues and challenges with scaling our internal teams for governance and across multiple AWS accounts for our own needs. So we took all the experience we got internally and the best of it, and then we worked with customers like yourselves, and we built AWS Control Tower. With AWS Control Tower, you can set up your environment for governance in as little as 30 minutes. Control Tower helps you. One, it helps you set up your multi-account AWS environment for governance with best practices. Second, it lets you keep up with evolving governance changes because we all know, and I've experienced this, governance does not stop once you're done with setup. And third, it lets you monitor your environment in order to make sure that it stays with the compliance level that you wanted when you set it up. And now we can go to the slide. I glitched a little bit. So in governance, having control over your digital assets, which is also known as digital sovereignty, is more important now than ever before. So today, I'm excited to launch a new capability in AWS Control Tower. We are releasing 65 AWS managed controls with enhanced region deny capabilities, all of this to meet your digital sovereignty needs. With this release, you can discover controls under a new digital sovereignty group within your Control Tower console, and you can use these, one, to prevent actions, you can help enforce configurations, you can detect resource changes for any data residency, and you can also provide granular access restriction, you can provide encryption and resiliency capabilities with this launch. So, we're going to do another one, and hopefully this time I don't glitch it as badly. So take out your phones again, and let's do another live poll. This time, it's about what keeps you up at night. And I know for me, when my page goes off, it could be any of these, to be honest. But personally, I'm trying to recall what was the last alarm that went off, and it was probably growth of data and workloads, which typically auto-scaling group, or one of those things fails, and that's my impression. However, let's see what the audience thought about what is the primary thing that keeps you up at night. So 10 seconds, and now let's check out the results. Okay, wow, a lot of them were pretty close. Keeping costs under control, okay, we're gonna talk about that, and managing growth and workloads, and then hybrid and multi-cloud. Okay, so let's move on. We obviously, cloud operations helps you, so no matter what your challenge, AWS Cloud Operations can help you with all of these. Moving on now. Now that we've covered governance, let's talk a little bit about observability and taking action. So you can't manage what you cannot see. And in operations, we typically say log everything. I know that's what I did, writing code. You'd log everything into a file system because everything ultimately starts with the log. And in the case of Amazon, our operational excellence is built into Amazon CloudWatch, which is our flagship observability service. And in fact, we use it to monitor and observe all the way from Amazon.com to all our AWS services internally. Once you are observing your environment, you also need to continuously monitor and evaluate the compliance of your resources. That's where AWS Config comes in. You can monitor the configuration of tens of thousands of virtual machines, manage databases, storage, and networking components, both on AWS as well as other cloud providers. And with visibility comes the need for your resources. When you need to take action, you need to be able to see your resources and remediate. That's where Systems Manager comes in. With Systems Manager, you can simplify infrastructure management and automate processes such as patching and resource changes, both on AWS as well as other clouds. So we at AWS do believe that customers get the best experience, the best performance, and the most cost benefit when you choose a primary cloud provider. However, having said that, we understand that several of you seek support in hybrid and multi-cloud environments, and we are committed to helping you be successful no matter what approach you choose to take. You can extend AWS Cloud Operations across hybrid and multi-cloud environments for secure and seamless management, compliance, and observability. So today, I'm really excited to announce Amazon CloudWatch now supports data querying from multiple sources, allowing you to gain visibility across your hybrid and multi-cloud environments for all of your metrics in a single view. With this feature, you can consolidate and visualize metrics in a single view and single location, whether your sources are Amazon OpenSearch, Prometheus, Azure Monitor, or even your own custom data sources, such as Amazon RDS or a file on Amazon S3. You can configure your data source once within minutes and start querying it for metrics in real time. And you can overlay the data on the very same graphs and dashboards that you normally use, thereby reducing the need for you to switch among multiple tools, and it reduces the cost of duplicating your metrics both on AWS and elsewhere. You can also, most importantly, you can also detect an alarm on any issues using this same feature. Next, a new feature that I'm excited to share is the low-code visual editor, designer in AWS Systems Manager Automation. As applications grow in complexity and diversity, both DevOps and SecOps teams find themselves creating these automation runbooks to scale their operation actions efficiently across their infrastructure and applications. And they want to do this in a safe and secure manner. But these teams still need to create the runbook logic, and they have to debug all of these automation workflows. With this launch now in Systems Manager, we let you author and edit these runbooks with a low-code visual interface, which means you can simply drag and drop both automation actions as well as AWS APIs onto a canvas, and you can simply connect them as steps so you can visualize your entire runbook. You can also use Python scripts within your runbook for security vulnerability, thereby enhancing your security posture. In addition to helping you be more efficient. It looks like we might have missed one release, but anyway. In addition to helping you be more efficient on AWS hybrid and multi-cloud, we really believe it's important, and I remember this from the previous poll, it was number one on your choice. You want to control your costs. So we want to help you reduce your IT management spend as well as your operations spend. We are helping you reduce costs in CloudWatch, and today I'm excited to announce a new logs class within CloudWatch called Amazon CloudWatch Logs in Frequent Access. This new logs class is purpose-built for consolidating all your logs on AWS. It offers all the same managed ingestion, cross-account log analytics, as well as encryption of CloudWatch logs. All of this at 50% lower ingestion price per gigabyte. This feature is ideal for when you're doing ad hoc querying or after-the-fact forensic analysis. Consolidating all your logs in CloudWatch, again, helps you eliminate the operational overhead of switching and having multiple solutions for you to analyze all your logs, and you can do it in one place using Log Insights. Now, of course, you can continue to use the standard log group when you want to do advanced analytics or have real-time visibility. Another launch that's going to help you operate efficiently at scale is periodic recording within AWS Config. Periodic recording gives you the option to capture configuration changes once every 24 hours instead of doing so continuously. For example, let's say you have an Amazon EC2 instance that has had multiple configuration changes in a 24-hour period. With continuous recording, you will get an update for every single configuration item that changed. But with periodic recording, you will receive a configuration item for the most recent change only if it differs from the previous state, item state that changed. And by reducing the total number of changes and the volume that's delivered to you, we are reducing the cost that it takes you to have to, in order to be able to scale your continuous tracking, but in a more thoughtful manner where you have less items delivered to you. And more importantly, you can choose to control the resource types that you want tracked using continuous versus periodic recording, and you can do this even within the same AWS account. Finally, we know that many of you organize your teams by applications, and you use services such as AWS Cost Explorer to help you manage your costs. I'm excited to share with you today that we are now making it even easier for you to manage costs by application. Instead of manually activating a cost allocation tag for your resource, you can now use this new AWS application tag that will automatically be activated for cost allocation within every AWS account as well as commercial region. With this tag, you can now track the cost of not just your individual resource, but by resources by application. And if you choose to use Security Hub, your security findings are now automatically enriched with this tag, so you have an easy way for you to assess your security posture of all of your applications as well. With these enhancements, this is just a small glimpse into all the enhancements and capabilities we have for applications operations. And honestly, you're going to see so much more of these capabilities. So please attend the Thursday keynote by our Vice President and CTO of Amazon.com, Dr. Werner Vogels. He's going to be sharing so many more of these capabilities on Thursday. So what you've just seen is how AWS is helping you innovate. We are innovating on your behalf to make it simpler for you to set up and govern your environment. so that you can have continuous compliance. We help you operate on AWS in hybrid environments as well as multi-cloud, and we are working to really make it more cost-effective for you as well. So what better way than to see all of this come together with our second voice of the customer? And you're going to hear a story from Disney. It gives me goosebumps because I already saw a sneak peek on how they are using AWS for their cloud operations, and they're optimizing costs, which was the number one on the previous poll. So stay tuned and help me in welcoming Alexi from Disney to the stage.
Thank you. I tell you, I work for one of the greatest companies out there. I get to create magic with technology every day. But sometimes that's hard when you're creating magic. If you look at all those iconic brands that are up there in media and entertainment and in parks and resorts, they all touch somebody's lives just about every day. The way Disney's structured, it has three main areas: Disney Entertainment, ESPN, and Disney Experiences. I work in a corporate function in Disney Enterprise Technology, and our team is there to help enable teams to create magic. We really want to focus on enabling, but when you look at the number of different brands up there and the thousands of engineering teams out there, it really is difficult to scale that across all those teams. So really, how do we enable this to make it easy for people to consume the cloud at the cloud speed? We really want to focus on enabling consistent agility. In the beginning, it used to take weeks or days just to set up a cloud account. Had to go through different teams to set up different things, make different connectivities, apply different roles. And it took engineers a lot of time to get up and running. And so one of the things that we've done has built a centralized team to help with that. But we focused on some different things. Instead of focusing on how do you submit tickets to different queues, we focused on automation. We focused on self-service. And we focused on speed to deliver. How do we enable engineers to be able to consume the cloud safely, securely, reliably, and at an optimized state? By leveraging some of the tools that Amazon provides, we've been able to refactor our solution to be able to help get teams up and running in minutes versus days. When we set up new accounts, we apply over 40 to 50 different opinions against those accounts so that we know that it's in a good state and that the engineers can focus on the more important things. This takes under, you know, minutes to an hour to actually get set up, and it saved countless number of hours of our engineering team in setup time for it. This allows them to redirect their focus on realizing business value and creating that and getting it out there faster. We're constantly looking for new ways to actually make this better and enable our engineers. Data and observability is another space that we focus on. The cloud produces a ton of data that is very valuable and is useful to the engineers when you're running cloud operations. How do you actually make that easily available across the various different teams at scale? If you don't manage it effectively, you have data sprawl. You have multiple different redundant sets of data coming out. And you need to give engineering teams easy access to this. You don't want to make them think about it. You just want it to be there for them. So we've leveraged technologies to help build this consolidation into a consistently managed platform. This allows us to empower engineers and additional teams that need access to that data to come to one self-service stop to actually get that data. They're able to search across multiple different accounts for the output of this data, as leveraging some of the tools like Athena, and visualize them with some of the visualization tools that Amazon provides. And then finally, you know, it helps us ensure compliance is being met, because some of that data is needed for compliance in order to actually ensure that we're managing risk appropriately across the company for it. Again, part of what we did was incorporate this into the base account setup so that it's easily, so it's just there when you actually go through and set up your account for it. Finally, building upon that is leveraging the data. We really focus on how do we enable optimization at scale? How do we reduce the waste and optimize the resources that are being used? A lot of that comes from data that the cloud provides. So we have a huge data set coming in of cost and usage data. How do we actually take that data, make it meaningful for some of the engineers to actually make the right decisions on their applications? We had problems where teams were trying to download this file, work with it. We got into data sprawl, and it's such a large data set that having multiple copies of it ended up costing us a lot of money. What it also did was it segmented teams. So teams were off doing their own thing, and there wasn't the sharing of information across the organization. And so as a part of what we've delivered, we've been able to centralize this in a single location for us. We've been able to build a community around it so that we can actually share best practices across teams and actually take a look for patterns and practices that we can actually bubble up within the organization and build into our automation or customized reporting so that people can actually respond faster to it. This allows them to, again, focus on more on delivering the magic as opposed to how do I actually optimize this, my workloads? How do I actually get this data so that I understand what's going on there for it? Additionally, the self-service functions that we've been able to provide them makes it easy for them to access and actually makes them feel a part of the solution and want to come to actually leverage it. We've been on our cloud transformation for several years now, and we've realized that it's not a destination, it's a continuous journey. We're constantly trying to iterate on our solutions. On some of our solutions, we're on our third iteration of it, and we're constantly looking for new opportunities to provide value to the organization. In the future, we're working on developing new things, such as cloud scorecards, so that teams can easily see what they need to in order to understand what the risk is, what the reliability is, and what the optimization is from a cost standpoint for their systems. We do that by going out and talking to the engineers and understanding what they need and what's useful for them, which sometimes is very different as opposed to coming in with a solution. And we work with them to get a good feedback loop on that. Again, we continuously try to innovate on this and actually build upon what we've built in the past for the future. And with new releases coming out from Amazon, it actually helps us build faster and it gives us the ability to take advantage of them going forward. And with that, I'll turn it back over.
Wow, Disney, unbelievable. Thank you, Alexi, for sharing the story of how cloud operations, what kind of support do you need, right? There's 110 companies within Disney. That's mind-boggling. It's hard enough doing it for one business, forget about 110. And they have done this successfully and reaping the benefits of cost savings, risk reductions, and internal developer productivity, because ultimately it's all baked into the CI/CD pipelines for each of your businesses. So, want to switch gears a little bit now and look into what the future of cloud operations will look like. As machine learning artificial intelligence and generative AI gain momentum, AWS will continue to leverage these technologies to improve our cloud operations capabilities. And all of this in service of letting you set up and govern, observe and take action in the cloud anywhere, and you can all do all of this much more quickly and easily as we go into the tomorrow and beyond phase. So to help me showcase some of our new capabilities, I want all of you to buckle up because I'm going to show you some of the capabilities that take advantage of generative AI and machine learning capabilities. And I'm going to invite AWS Senior Principal Engineer David Janacek, who's going to take us on a journey. So welcome, David.
Thank you, Nandini. I love science fiction and how optimistic it is about what we'll be able to do in the future. And one of those kind of futuristic capabilities that I admire is how easy it is to get answers to questions that we might be having. You don't see people in sci-fi interacting, at least in the future in sci-fi, you kind of do in Star Wars, but that's in the past. Anyway, in the future, you see people not interacting with dials and knobs. You see them just asking and interacting with computers in human language. They're asking human questions and getting summarized answers. Now, I've been building and operating services at Amazon for over 17 years, from DynamoDB to Lambda. And in order to do the DevOps on those services, I've had to become proficient in many operational tools, including observability tools. And now building that expertise has taken a lot of time. It's taken practice. It's taken learning from my coworkers and seeing how they do things. And they'll run a command to get some answer, and I'll kind of file that away for future reference. Now, despite that expertise, I still get frustrated sometimes. When I'm trying to get an answer in an urgent situation, I might forget some specific detail on how to run some query or get the answer or use that nuance of the tool, and I have to go to the documentation. And so that's frustrating. I would rather just interact with this sci-fi computer here and ask it a question and have it figure out the right way to get me the data. So I'm going to show a demo now. Going through a story of troubleshooting that I'm sure you all are familiar with. We'll start with an alarm, we'll figure out what happened, we'll fix it, and we'll prevent it from happening again. So we're going to start off here in the CloudWatch alarm page. So we have some application whose availability has dipped. So we've gone down. There are a lot of ways to troubleshoot one of these things, but I'm going to demonstrate a logs feature instead of going to like traces or metrics and dashboards. So let's go and just look at the logs. One of the things when I'm troubleshooting is I just start by just glancing at the log to see if my human brain figures out a pattern, notices anything unusual in the logs. In this case, you can see there's not really a lot to look at there. I don't notice anything. Nothing jumps out at me. So we're going to need to do some deeper analytics. Let's go over to log insights, so where we can kind of run more analytics type of queries, slice and dice the logs in different ways. So here we are in log insights. But let's just to orient ourselves, do that same query. Let's just glance at the logs again. And we scroll down, and sure enough, there's not a lot there in terms of patterns. But one thing logs give us, the raw logs, is sort of like an emergency beacon from sci-fi of like, here's what happened, you know, to our starship when we ran into trouble. And the next people who come and find our spaceship can figure out what happened. And so one way that it's like an emergency beacon is by logging the kind of request ID or trace ID, you can then look and see what happened during, say, one website request. So let's copy the request ID out and just filter the logs just for that, because they're kind of mixed together. So we can just, but I don't remember exactly how to write the query to filter the logs. I can't remember the syntax. So we have the text box here that you can type in. You can see it's filled in the pre-filled query, but I don't remember. So we're going to need a little bit of help to be. So yes, we can. Yes. So we're going to use this query generator. This is the new capability. I don't remember this kind of query language, but I do remember English. So I'm going to type in and just ask the computer to get me the logs for that request. And so we can just type into that prompt. Just show me just the logs for this request. Notice how lazy I'm being. I'm just kind of typing in, oh, show me the log messages for, like, blah. I didn't even say that was a request ID. I just figured it out from my typing. And it generated the query that I wanted. Fields at message says just the log messages. That gives me just the log messages. And for request ID, it's just, oh, that must be a request ID. I'm just going to go ahead and do that for you. So it generated the right query. And so now we can hit run and scroll down, and we'll see actually that it is showing me that filtered query with just the log messages for that request ID. So I have found the emergency beacon for this request. But again, this is just if I'm looking for a single request, we haven't figured out what's wrong with the alarm overall. We need to kind of expand and look overall to see what's going on with the service. We might want to start by measuring how many failures are there over time to be able to kind of just make sense of whether this is where the problem is. So let's go and write a different type of query. And let's say, show me the number of errors per minute. And I didn't need to remember that the actual syntax for that involves some of these, like this query here. To say, give me these fields, filter just the errors out, stats, this is kind of grouped by in SQL. So this just figured it out. I didn't have to remember how to run that more analytics type of query. So we run the query and scroll down, and now we can see, even though these are logs we're querying, now we have a time series. We have the number of errors in the logs per minute, bucketed per minute. But that's not usually how I visualize time series data. I normally look at it as metrics. So we can actually, but in Logs Insights, whenever you have this type of results, you can just look at the visualization and view that time series as a time series. Okay, great. So why don't you kind of show us what we just saw?
Yeah, we're going to take a pause on the troubleshooting demo. I particularly love the beam me up David. We may have to beam him to all of you to troubleshoot, but because it was so quick and easy to miss. But what just happened was David asked an open-ended question, and the console generated the right CloudWatch query needed to answer his question. What you just saw was CloudWatch natural language query generation, which is powered by generative AI. You can ask it questions literally like how David asked. In addition, what David just showed you was for log insights, but this feature also works with metrics insight. And that's not all. You will be guided with a step-by-step explanation for each query so you can follow along and make sure that it meets what you need in terms of your answer. So now that we've got our logs, let's proceed with the rest of our troubleshooting story.
Great. Okay, so now and for the next chapter, one thing that I also like about sci-fi is when you're kind of scanning something in the distance, maybe looking at some faraway planet using some sensors, or you might get a signal that's kind of noisy. You can't really make sense of what's in there yet. And so you can ask the computer to just clean up that noisy signal. Maybe it's a radio signal with scramble, or if it's a video that's like a little bit noisy, you can just say enhance or something like that. And now, Nandini, this is what you wrote your master's thesis on?
Yep, I did a wavelet transformation and compression algorithms. I just wish I'd had these illustration skills when I was writing my thesis, but yes.
There's a time and a place for these kinds of illustrations, and this is the place. So let's use these kinds of techniques to make sense of not just this picture, but of the logs. So let's proceed on with chapter 2 of the demo. So here we are in Logs Insights, and remember, we just have a bunch of noisy logs. There's every log line in here is unique. Like, why is it so noisy? Because every log line has a request ID, it has a timestamp, it has just noise and variables in it. So what let's do is ask the computer to enhance. Let's just say, summarize the logs for me. Just tell me what's in there. It's hard to make sense. Oh, there I am again. Yep, let's figure it out. And that generates this time a pattern query. It's very simple. I could have just remembered pattern. I do know that. But I asked the query generator just to emphasize that. So this pattern command is going to summarize the log. It will take out all that unique, noisy, scrambled signal parts and distill it into fewer results. So here, they took all those log lines. So take that first row, for example. Let's kind of zoom in on that. You can see these substitution characters, that like just star, the star. Those are variables that it squashed, because it's like, oh, that's just noise. And you can see it actually, for that first log line, squashed 11,000 log lines into one. And so that means your eyes don't have to go through 11,000 log lines to see the more interesting pattern that's down below. So you're able to sift through the logs and find what's unique. You might find a unique pattern there that's interesting. Okay, so that took out the uniqueness, but what if I want to drill in and see, okay, what's in there? So that's what this inspect column is for, that you can go through any of these patterns and click on that magnifying glass to zoom in. You can zoom in and it shows you some samples of that pattern, just examples. And then it also, you can see it's kind of tokenized that pattern to say, okay, token one is the timestamp, token two is the request ID. What if you want to know what token three is? That's something my application is logging or something. So you can actually click on it and it'll show you the variables that make up that token and their frequency. So you can actually, we've actually gleaned some insight in how our customers are using this example application. Customers are calling this kind of browse products API more often than they are, say, the list pets API. This is sort of, that log line represents sort of the HTTP server handler kind of thing. Okay, great. But we still don't know what caused our alarm. I'm kind of taking a roundabout story to show you. But so, when I'm troubleshooting an alarm, I compare. I say, okay, the alarm happened now. What happened? Let's compare what we're seeing in the telemetry now versus before. So that's what, now it was hard to do when we just had raw logs because every log line was unique. So before and after, everything's different. But now that we have the ability to distill the logs into patterns, now we can do a meaningful diff. So I've clicked on the diff and I'm going to compare before and after. And now immediately have the answer. Like, that is actually what we could have started with. It shows us that we're having provisioned throughput exceeded exceptions coming back from DynamoDB. That means our table was under provisioned for the workload that we needed. That is the problem. That is the source of the errors of the alarm, just by being able to summarize the logs and then compare before and after. You couldn't do that with just the raw logs. It was hard to do. So you can zoom in this tool, and it shows you the time series of that log pattern before and after. And it's actually also shown the actual root cause. The root cause is all of the patterns have increased in their frequency before, after compared to before. That means our website just saw an increase in traffic. We're just kind of suffering from our own success here. We've had an increase in traffic, and we forgot to have enough throughput provision for the DynamoDB table. So we've figured it out, and now we have the root cause.
Great. Let's take another pause briefly to take a look at what David just showed us. So this is truly like finding a needle in a haystack. Such a time saver, this feature. What you just saw was CloudWatch Log's anomaly detection feature, which is an automated log analytics feature that uses machine learning to analyze and find those patterns and trends for you. Increasing volume and diversity of data makes it really hard for you to understand what changed over time. So this feature can be turned on with a single click, so it's always on for you, so that it can proactively alert when you receive any new patterns or changes to existing patterns. Okay, so now we found the logs. How do we go about mitigating what we just saw?
Got it. So let's now fix and prevent it from happening again. And so another kind of sci-fi trope is that when you, and how kind of altruistic things are in the future, is that when you find some problem, you go and share what you've learned with everybody else. So maybe we kind of steered into some nebula and found that that nebula is actually alive or something, I don't know, some sci-fi thing. You want to warn the other starships in the area to say, hey, avoid that thing, this is dangerous. And so, like, let's actually go and do that. Let's fix the problem and then tell everybody else in our company about this, some best practice or way to avoid this DynamoDB provisioning problem. So let's go on with chapter three now. So here we are in the DynamoDB table view. This is the table that had the under-provisioning issue. So we're just looking at that. We need to actually now dial up the throughput for this table. We can go over and just confirm that this is what's wrong, but okay, let's go to the monitor tab and we'll confirm that actually, yes, in fact, you can see from this graph, we are seeing read throttle events, that's a whole bunch, and the read usage on the left is actually capped out. It's trying to go higher and it's not able to because of the provisioning. So it's a perfectly elastic service. We just haven't, we're not using it right. So let's fix it. Go to Actions, Edit Capacity. Now, instead of just dialing up the throughput, let's just make our lives easier from here on and switch to on-demand mode. DynamoDB will now just scale things up and down as it needs to. Just easy mode. So let's zoom into the future. Let's go a couple, the time has elapsed. It's the cooking show thing. A couple minutes have elapsed. Now we go back to the monitor tab, and yep, the read throttles are gone. And the read usage is up, which is what we wanted. Fantastic. We've now discovered a best practice that it's on-demand tables are more responsive to changes in throughput. So let's go warn all the other captains. Let's go to AWS config, and where we're going to run a query and say, find all of the other DynamoDB tables in my account that I want to warn, that I need to do something about. But I don't remember how to use this query language. I can in AWS config. It's SQL. I'm actually more familiar with SQL. But I don't remember the exact parameters or whatever to enter. So new language, natural language query processor there. I can just say, show me all the DynamoDB tables that aren't using on-demand, even contractions it supports. So it's just a really simple, again, kind of a lazy question. And I just ask the computer, and it generates the right query for me, which is this. It's show me all these resources of DynamoDB type that have capacity mode not on demand. Easy. And you run the query, and here we have a list of all the starships that we need to contact in the area to let them know about this new practice of better, maybe easier practice of using on-demand tables in DynamoDB. Now, I could have actually, I was using AWS config here. I could have actually just used other governance tools. Like, I could have actually just gone to Control Tower, and this exact like case of finding and fixing DynamoDB tables to make them on-demand, that's actually in Control Tower. So it could have been even an easier mode for this. I just wanted to show you the new query capability in config.
This is so great. This demo got increasingly better with your sci-fi computer. So what David showed us again is the new natural language query generation capability in AWS config. Talk about simplifying resource configuration, investigations, and search. You can also use the generated queries as is, or you can fine-tune so you have a more granular query as you need, similar to what we saw earlier. So no more spending time on learning SQL, all the various flavors of it. It's simple as David demoed here. No coding required. Thank David. Let's thank David for showing us a fantastic sci-fi demo.
Thanks.
So I hope David's demo was a little bit of a glimpse into the future of how we see cloud operations. As our CEO, Andy Jassy, said, we are three steps into a marathon, and I could not agree more. Think about what the future of cloud operations could look like one day. Most operational tasks will be automated. They will be self-optimizing, self-configuring, and self-remediating. In this demo, David would have had to know the query ID when he was troubleshooting. Instead, today he was able to ask open-ended natural language questions. What if we could create behind the scene leveraging generative AI, et cetera, so David didn't even need to ask the question. We would have no need for this demo because the sci-fi computer would have figured out what to do on its own. So stay tuned for more in this space. With the help of generative AI, quantum computing, and honestly, even virtual and augmented reality, you can see some demos on the show floor on this, these operational tasks will be even more faster to remediate and resolve. This frees you up so you can focus on what's important for you and your business, which is, do I have the right governance controls in place? And are you helping your developer teams retool and skill themselves for this changing momentum that we are seeing? And AWS is here to consistently support you in making the best decisions for your business. The future of cloud operations will be easy, it'll be seamless, and you will be able to make decisions at warp speed. We are excited to continue to building and taking cloud operations to the next level by working with each and every one of you, our customers. So let's work together for a safe and efficient future in cloud operations. There's a lot to learn this week here at reInvent. Here are some of the sessions that go into some of the features and capabilities we showcased today, but there is so much more to learn. So please take out your phones and take a picture. Also, check out the catalog for more sessions. And I would encourage you to go see David's sessions, especially if you liked his graphics. COP243, which is listed right there. And there's, if it's full, there, he's doing multiple sessions of it. So please look out for that. And with that, since you have your phones out, please take the session survey. We always look forward to that, the result of that. And with that, we've come to the end of our presentation. You've heard from two amazing customers. I'd like to thank Sandhya and Alexi from JP Morgan Chase and Disney for joining me here. And of course, big kudos to David for walking us through the demo. And thank you, all of you watching online, as well as all of you for spending the last hour with me. Enjoy the rest of Vegas.